Students, let's talk about chapter 15, our environment. Environment is our surrounding ambience. And what are the functions of our environment? It is to recycle nutrients and to transfer energy. Now, what happens when we add waste to our environment? Now, these waste will be lying in the surrounding and they'll be decaying, but the decay may be very slow for most of the things. For example, suppose how much time plastics will take to decay? Almost a million year. Banana peel, 3 to 4 weeks. Nylon cloth, 1 year. Leather shoes, 40 to 50 years. Thermocol, infinity. Cotton cloth, 5 months. Jute, 1 month. And steel, it's a metal, or maybe 100 years. Let's see why things are biodegradable or non-biodegradable. Like when we eat food, we eat basically the carbohydrates for getting energy. And there the carbon and carbon bonds, they are broken down, and that is what gives us energy. But then we cannot eat coal. We cannot digest coal because we don't have any enzyme to digest it. Similarly, when the plastic is thrown into the surrounding, it is non-biodegradable because it's a man-made substance and there are no microorganisms to digest it. Now, as in the activity 15.2, use your library or internet to find out more about biodegradable and non-biodegradable substances. How long are various non-biodegradable substances expected to last in the environment? We have just discussed. These days, new types of plastics which are said to be biodegradable are available. Find out more about such materials and whether they do or do not harm the environment. Yes, these days we have biodegradable plastics which are made from cornstarch. Now, why are some substances biodegradable and others are non-biodegradable? You know, because there are microorganisms that can degrade them, decompose them. And for non-biodegradable, there is no microorganism that may be decomposing them. Give any two ways in which biodegradable substances would affect the environment. They'll be decomposed and they'll be adding nutrients in the ecosystem. There will be recycling. Give any two ways in which non-biodegradable substances would affect the environment. They accumulate and persist in the surrounding, and they can choke drains and water bodies. Now let's talk about ecosystem. What are its components? Now ecosystem is all living and non-living components in the together constitute an ecosystem. Now what are the components of ecosystem? Now an ecosystem consists of biotic and abiotic components. Biotic means all the living organisms. It could be the plants, animals, or microorganisms, and it could be abiotic means the light, temperature, air, soil, wind, or even the minerals. Now here in this activity 15.3, they have asked to set up an aquarium. Now an aquarium is supposed to be an artificial ecosystem. So how many different types of ecosystems can be there? Ecosystems can be natural, which are self-sustaining, like a pond, a forest, or a grassland, or they could be artificial. They are non-self-sustaining, like a crop field or an aquarium. Let's see what are the biotic components of an ecosystem. Biotic components are producers, autotrophs, consumers, and decomposers. Decomposers mainly constitute the microorganisms. Now let us see activity 15.4. While creating an aquarium, did you take care not to put aquatic animals which would eat each other's? Yes, we do. What would have happened otherwise? The high trophic level organisms would have eaten all the previous level trophic level organisms. Like all the herbivores would have eaten the plants, and the carnivores would have eaten the herbivores. Make groups and discuss how each of the above groups organisms are dependent on each other. In fact, they are all linked together by a food chain or a food web. Write the aquatic organisms in order of who eats whom and from a chain at least 3 steps. In an aquatic system, there will be phytoplanktons, they are the free floating plants, and there are insect larvae that will be feeding on the phytoplanktons, and further the next trophic level will be of the fish, which will be eating on the eating the insect larvae. Would you consider any one group of organisms to be primary importance? Why or why not? No, all of them, they are equally important, all play important role in an ecosystem. Now let's see what are food chain and food webs. Now the series of organisms taking part at various biotic levels form a food chain. A food chain can be something like this. The first trophic level always remains the producers, the plants, the green plants. They are fed upon by some herbivores and finally the carnivores. Or it could be have many an insect feeding on the plants, a frog feeding on the insects, a snake feeding on frog, and a hawk or an eagle feeding on the snake. Now all the trophic levels are interconnected by the flow of energy. Now the flow of energy between various components of the environment has been extensively studied and has been found that the green plants in a terrestrial ecosystem capture about 1% of energy of sunlight that falls on their leaves and convert it into food energy. And the green plants are eaten by primary consumers. A great deal of energy is lost as heat to the environment. Some amount goes to digestion and doing work, and the rest goes towards growth and reproduction. An average of only 10% of the food eaten is turning into its own body and made available to the next level of consumers. That means only 10% of energy moves to the next trophic level. So if it is the energy absorbed by from the sun by the plants is only 1%, then after every trophic level the energy that is being transferred to the next trophic level is only 10%. We call it as 10% energy loss. Now since so little energy is available for the next level of consumers, food chain generally consists of only 3 or 4 steps. The loss of energy at each step is so great that very little usable energy remains after 4 trophic levels. So there are only a few trophic levels in the ecosystem. There are generally a greater number of individuals at the lower trophic levels of an ecosystem, and the greatest number of being is the producers. So as we move up the trophic levels, the producers will be more in number generally. The length and complexity of food chains vary greatly. Each organism is generally eaten up by 2 or more other kinds of organisms, which in turn are eaten up by several other organisms. So instead of a straight line food chain, relationships can be shown as a series of branching lines called a food web. In fact, a food web is nothing but a interconnecting food chains, and they are realistic, they are not idealistic in nature. What is inferred from the energy flow diagrams then? That the flow of energy is unidirectional. Energy is lost in large amount when it goes to the next trophic level. This is lost in doing many of the metabolic activities, and more energy is available at the to the autotrophs, that is the lowest trophic level. Now in a food chain there is another interesting aspect that could be seen, and this is called biomagnification. Now what is biomagnification? It is the accumulation of harmful chemicals which are non-biodegradable in high trophic levels. Now what actually happens when we spray insecticides on grass or crop field? They are eaten up by the herbivores, and the herbivores in turn by the carnivores, and these chemicals, because they are non-biodegradable, they'll be accumulating in the food chain, and they are accumulated finally in the highest trophic level, maybe that is the human beings. So now as per the activity 15.5, newspapers report that pesticide levels in our ready-made food items are often seen these days, and some states have banned these products. Debate in groups the need of such bans. Is such bans are needed because these chemicals are accumulating in the human beings? Source of what do you think would be the source of pesticide in our food? They are the one that are sprayed on the crops. Could pesticide get into our bodies from this source through other food products also? Yes, from the preservatives, from the fruit ripening chemicals, and from the colorants and adulterants. Discuss what methods would be applied to reduce our intake of pesticides. We can go for organic farming, we can go for biological control methods, biofertilizers use in the fields, and use of biopesticides. Now let's see how other activities affect our environment. You know, there is an ozone layer in the stratosphere, in the atmosphere. Ozone is nothing but a molecule formed by 3 atoms of oxygen. It is a deadly poison otherwise, but in stratosphere it helps us in shielding us from UV rays. It acts like an umbrella. Now in the 1980s, what was found was that the thickness of this ozone layer was depleting, and it was because of the use of CFCs. CFCs are chlorofluorocarbons emitted in the atmosphere. Now these CFCs, they are emitted from the refrigerants, and they are used in the fire extinguishers. So in 1987, the United Nations Environment Program, UNEP, succeeded in forging an agreement to freeze CFC production at 1986 levels. Now what actually happens is when we emit CFCs in the atmosphere, ozone is broken down because of these chlorides present in the CFCs, this chlorofluorocarbon, into oxygen and nascent oxygen. Now let's see how to manage the garbage we produce. Now in our homes we are producing a lot of garbage, and that could be biodegradable, that could be non-biodegradable, and that could be recyclable or reusable. Now calculate how much waste is generated in our home. Almost a bin filled. In our schools similarly, a bin filled, dustbin filled. And how much of this waste is biodegradable? Most of it is biodegradable only, except for those plastic bags. And so what we need to do is we need to segregate the waste into biodegradable, non-biodegradable and recyclable, and appropriately we can dispose them off. Suppose the biodegradable waste could be used in the compost pit, non-biodegradable could be incinerated, and recyclable can be recycled. Now what happens to the sewage in our locality? Sewage means it's the municipality waste. Now for treating this sewage, there are sewage treatment plants or the effluent treatment plants, ETPs. Now let's see how our improvement in our lifestyle has led to more pollution in our surrounding. Now these days we have packaged food products, the plastic packaging, the polythene bags, the disposable products that are more harmful in the surrounding because they are non-biodegradable. Then long back it was thought of using disposable cups in the train. But these disposable cups were polluting the environment, so they were replaced by clay coolers. But then slowly it was found that in the long run, this will be depleting the topsoil.
So that is how now.
Now these days we are generating a lot of e-waste also. And how to dispose of this e-waste? We need to segregate things and appropriately disposing them off. Like the biodegradable things, they could be used in the compost pit. Non-biodegradable could be incinerated, that they're electrically burned, and the recyclable can be recycled, like the metals, they could be recycled.